Here ends the reading from God's holy word.
Maddie and her mother are part of a group of 10 that are going with a leader to India right after Christmas. And we hope you have a wonderful experience, both of you over there with the rest of the group. Here's how I began being a pastor. In June 1968, I graduated from college, and the next day, five churches in Brooklyn hired me to start a youth ministry, to take the kids of Flatbush off the streets during a particularly hot time in American history. I started with nothing and nobody. I started a coffee house ministry for teenagers, a vacation Bible school, a day camp, Bible study, and preached. That September, I started seminary. And the first thing they had was a job fair where all these Boston area churches came together to hire kids like me to do church work. Believe me when I tell you, I knew nothing, nothing. And yet overnight, I'm running youth groups, teaching confirmation, teaching Sunday school, starting a drop-in center, and beginning another coffee house ministry. My immersion into ministry literally was a baptism by fire. I was tossed to the wolves. In short order, I found myself a pastor, a preacher, a teacher. I was battling organized crime. That's a story for another Sunday. I got beaten up. I was dealing with drugs and guns and runaways and doing counseling. All of that at the age of 21 with about 2 weeks of seminary under my belt. Sometimes we have to learn by doing. As you know, our Bible study this fall has been on what the Bible teaches about leadership. And there's a lot of fascinating lessons in there. Most of the Bible's best leaders were humble and reluctant on the one hand, but when they got to it, they were actually quite bullish and determined and forceful. And this was true of all of the biggies in the Bible, Abraham and Moses and Paul and the prophets and Solomon and Mary and Deborah. They were all quite shocked that they had been made into leaders, but once committed to it, it was full speed ahead. Last week in this Bible study series, we turned to Jesus as a leader, and this week we looked at how Jesus as a leader trained his disciples. And frankly, his method was the David Rowe school of leadership. Just toss them overboard and see if any of them can swim. In Matthew chapter 10, we see that Jesus gathered his 12 disciples together. And he starts off by giving them a nice pat on the back, and then he sends them off two by two into the rural towns and villages throughout Israel. And he tells them to preach and to heal the sick and to raise the dead and to cleanse the lepers. And by the way, don't worry about anything. So much for training. Now, I suppose we could say that at least they had been watching Jesus in action for a year or so. And it's true even for me. I had the advantage of watching my father as I grew up as my pastor. I got to watch him in action. But watching is a whole lot different than doing. What got me thinking about this was my last Sunday sermon when I delved a bit into the role of faith and politics. And I explained why I believe in the separation of church and state, which is why we don't tell you how to vote. Instead, what we try to do is to make faith real and relevant, something that is intrinsically part of us. And so we then take that out into the world. When we are at our best in here, what happens in here shapes what we do out there. We lead by example. We all lead by example. You watch me and Alita and I, we watch you, and we watch one another. And in that way, we see what matters, and we learn what to do. This is our training in here. We are a church that feeds the hungry and settles a refugee family and treasures children and loves doing weddings and affirms teenagers and cares for the elderly and looks out for the neighbor and the stranger and the lost. It's just who we are. It's what we talk about in here. We teach it and we preach it and we sing it. And then we take all of that out onto the commuter train on Monday, and we take it into the voting booth, and we take that out onto the playing fields and the classrooms, all of those places where we work, the places where we sit down with our family at the dinner table, or wherever we have those hot topic discussions with friends, we take that with us. Who we are out there and how we live out there is not alien to what we think about in here. Today I'm going to tell you four stories from our church family. Folks who sit near you right in the pews this morning, your friends, your neighbors, folks who found it in their heart to love their neighbor in surprising ways. Joanna Patterson, Ann and Saranya Singapore, Dave and Ann Harvey, Brenda and Jeff Steele. They are heroes of our faith in daily life, in quiet, unassuming, surprising ways. One family had some new neighbors recently. A group of men moved into a cottage nearby. Perhaps not your typical Greenfield Hill family. Generally, we are finely educated, finely employed, fine families. These guys went to the school of hardest knocks, the battlefields of Afghanistan and Iraq. They'd already lost one friend to the weariness of war, to the alarming epidemic of soldier suicide. They were about to lose another just last Sunday. Our church friends entered into their world, neighbor to neighbor, bringing over homemade muffins and a friendly voice, trying to be a living embodiment of the good news to some guys who don't hear much good news. We never know what we will find when we open up our front doors, do we? And we turn left or we turn right. We open our eyes, we walk around, and we see what's about. For another family, indeed their whole family, and for a circle of friends, for them, it was a young boy, alone, bruised by a harsh life, abandoned by the very basics that we all take for granted, hope, home, love. It's not easy to open your heart to a heart that you know is already broken, to a spirit that has already been so fully crushed. And yet this family did what I know many of our church families have done when they dared to open up their front door, amazed at what was waiting outside, waiting for someone, something, somehow, someday. And suddenly it's these church families, our friends, saying, well, I guess this is that someday, and we are the someones who have to do something somehow. Bob Dylan just won the Nobel Prize for Literature, something I happen to agree with. He spent a lifetime challenging us to be better than we often settle for. In one song he stated, each of us has his own special gift, and you know this was meant to be true, and you won't underestimate me, and I won't underestimate you. That's sort of the art of being a Christian, not to underestimate the humanity of someone else, and not to underestimate our own power to change the world, one person at a time. If the Nobel Prize was given 2,000 years ago, I think Jesus might have won for literature. Our scripture lesson that you just heard today, the parable of the Good Samaritan, along with the parable of the prodigal son, are often considered two of the greatest short stories ever written, and I agree. In today's story, that Good Samaritan is just like all of us. He gets up one day, no particular day, he goes out the front door, no idea what awaits him. Could be just another routine day, go to work, trudge around, make a sale, put some money in your pocket, go home, live for another day, a Willy Loman sort of day. Or he could find a person lying in the road, his life force beaten out of him by the evils of the day, a victim of heartless, cynical, vulgar brutality. Government failed him, society failed him, religion passed him by, literally. And all of a sudden, there's the Samaritan and the victim together in the road, side by side. Nobody's watching, Nobody would know. The Samaritan could have just turned his back, walked on by, just like the two religious people did. After all, and we would agree, to do something is a big risk. Getting involved, emotional attachment, time lost, resources used up. And what if he's a fake? What if it's a scam? What if he's ungrateful? What if he's a danger? Well, the Bible tells us the Good Samaritan stops, and he washes the man's wounds, and he picks him up, and he puts him on his donkey, and he carries him to safety, and he says to the innkeeper, here's some money, and I'll pay whatever it takes for him to recover. Now, by the way, I should mention why Jesus told this story. A man had come up to him and asked him two questions. Number one, how do I get to heaven? How do I get to heaven? And number two, who is my neighbor? To Jesus, those two questions are linked. How you get to heaven and who you think of as your neighbor go hand in hand. And after those questions, Jesus tells the story of the Good Samaritan. The one person who takes the time to stop, to notice, to see, to care, and to do the right thing. Not like the others in the story who were too busy, too holy, didn't want to get their hands dirty, didn't want to get involved, didn't want to get delayed to the next appointment, didn't want to waste the time or the resources. And when the story is over, Jesus asks, who is the real neighbor here? Who has the doors of heaven wide open? Our third church family literally found their neighbor on their doorstep. A teenage girl from the block came to see them distraught. She couldn't wake her father. When you're 15 or 16, death doesn't seem possible. It's not a reality. It's so remote. And so our third family went with the girl to her house, and the man went upstairs to the dad, and the mom sat with the girl. The ambulance and the medics came, and the professionals did their very professional work to the best of their ability, but it was too late. And it was our friends who surrounded this young girl, who shared the saddest news, who loved her unconditionally, who truly, truly were neighbors. This is how it goes sometimes. We don't know what the day will bring. We don't know what the neighbor will need. We don't know who will come knocking on the doors of our heart, who will cross the threshold of our lives, who will need the comfort of your embrace. We don't know. One morning, the mom from our fourth family went for a walk in her neighborhood. She saw a young woman. Something wasn't right. She could sense that there was some need there, some hurt, undefined, unclear. She was wearing a hospital bracelet on her wrist, maybe a runaway, maybe a walkaway, maybe just alone. It was the kind of situation easy to ignore, some might say best to ignore early morning. A stranger, something out of place, maybe better to call the police, maybe turn away, maybe convince yourself not to get involved in somebody else's business. Our church member invited the young woman into her home, let her take a shower, gave her some clothes and some breakfast, and called a leader. Together, they befriended someone who felt a long way from any friendship. They comforted her, they gained her trust, they reunited her with her mother. Four stories from our little country church. No big deals, no headlines in the newspapers, no earth-shaking transformation of the universe. Russia and America aren't suddenly smiling. Israel and Palestine aren't hugging. Trump and Clinton aren't planning a post-election vacation together. But the gates of heaven have opened wider, and God's smiling, and so are we. When I asked these dear friends if I could tell their stories, they were all quite amazed. None of them felt like they were especially worthy of note. But their comments afterward are so, so beautiful. Let me share some of them with you. I wish I could do more of that each day. We just did what we could. I felt like I was being my true self for those few hours. We talked with our kids about loving our neighbors as ourselves, and sometimes that's hard. It's hard to face your fears and your prejudices and to reach out. I will never forget their gratitude. I wanted to show some love, and all I got back was love. And we all learned something. We don't feel like we did anything special other than give some love to someone in need. Wow. Do you know how much theology is in those words? How much basic Christianity, how much basic humanity, basic ethics, basic divine spark in those words? We did what we could. We gave some love to someone in need. And all we got back was love. And we learned something too. I wish I could do more of that each day. I felt like I was being my true self for those few hours. And guess what? They did that without going to seminary. Just like the disciples when Jesus sent them out two by two. Just like the Good Samaritan on that road long ago. Our first four church families simply lived our simple faith in the simplest ways possible. Our goal in being in here is to be like that out there. Our final hymn this morning, very lovely, 612, O Jesus, I Have Promised, we'll sing just verses 1 and 2 of 612.